Hello everybody, I am Soumya Murthy. I am doing this video as a revision for agricultural economics topics. Basically, this is for the rural economy of India topic with agricultural economics. So let's summarize as to what we have learned in this topic. Basically, it was about the structure of Indian economy and the three stages that we discussed about pre-colonial, colonial and post-colonial stages in India, and also about the three sectors, that is primary, secondary and the tertiary sector. So when we see the structure of Indian economy, basically we all know that it is basically a primarily a developing economy where the majority of the population is dependent on agriculture. And we also find that we are a populous country and majority of our population are unemployed, and more than 60% of our population are living below the poverty line. And at the same time, we find that the people who have jobs are basically lacking technical skills, which is acting as a main hindrance for development of our country. Now, when we look into the economic history of India, we find that basically it is divided into three phases: the pre-colonial, colonial and post-colonial phase. We all know in pre-colonial, basically it was even before the advent of the British into India, wherein during the Indus Valley Civilization stage, wherein India was well self-sufficient with its needs. All the villages were self-sufficient with all the goods that was required and didn't have to depend on anybody or move out of that particular place to fend for itself. But with the advent of the British, with the British East India Company moving into India, we face problems where all our resources were taken away by the British. The unfinished goods or the raw materials were taken from India, moved to England, and they converted that into finished products, and that was again brought back to India and sold at a very higher price. So this was a major drain that happened to our economy. Post-colonial, once we came out of the British rule and India became independent, the government had to bring in a lot of plans, and they had to plan for the revival and improvement of Indian economy. We had the fire plans implemented, many policies and schemes brought in, wherein the government planned to bring in change in agriculture, change in industries, change in terms of service sectors. So we see that economy was primarily classified into three sectors, that is primary sector, secondary sector and tertiary sector. As we all know, primary sector basically deals with the agricultural sector or the raw materials that are available in that nature. The secondary sector makes use of these raw materials available from the primary sector and converts that into a finished goods and sell it in the market. And the third sector, the tertiary sector, is basically associated with the service industries. So your banking, insurance, transport, communication all come under the tertiary sector. And we see that when we compare how India transformed itself from being basically a sector which was agrarian nature, or basically which was primary sector, which was dominating the economy, to, you know, moving on to the secondary sector with all the incentives given to the industries, and finally we have moved to the tertiary sector, wherein our service sector is contributing majorly to the development and growth of our country. So let's summarize what we have discussed in the place of agriculture in Indian economy. We know that Indian economy basically is primarily dependent on agriculture. So we know that major population is dependent on agriculture, and majority of the population who are living in the rural areas are basically associated with agriculture. So agriculture and related activities form the main source of livelihood, and the performance of agriculture sector plays a very, very important role for the growth of our country. Basically, we see that India has changed a lot because agriculture is now contributing to the GDP of India. We see that basically the industrialization that was brought in was actually, you know, associated with the contributions that was made in agriculture. So basically, we're trying to move on from becoming a very stable economy, increasing the food production, less dependency from the other countries. So we are basically the second largest producer in terms of rice, wheat, sugar. We are basically exporting a lot of items like spices, ginger, turmeric, etc. And basically a lot of fruits from India are having huge demand outside. So basically we are seeing a more powerful and a stable economy, which is going to be very powerful in the coming days. So moving on to the composition of the rural economy, we discussed about the composition that is there in the rural economy and also about the agricultural and non-agricultural sectors that exist in the rural economy. Basically, we all know that however developed or progressed a country may be, usually we find that there are two aspects in an economy, that is the rural and the urban areas. So basically it is, you know, we try to define it as a rural area or as an urban area based on the settlement that is there, on what basis the size of the settlement is and the type of economic activities that are undertaken by the people who stay there. So rural economy is defined as an area where, which is predominantly agricultural in nature. So agriculture and allied activities are the main occupation of these people who live in rural areas. So apart from agriculture, there is little of manufacturing and services that are also prevalent in the rural economy to some extent. And we find that when we look into the urban areas, we see that there is a change from the aspects that we see in terms of rural areas. We here find that they are more into non-farm sectors, or they are moved away from agriculture and allied activities. So there may be a little bit of agriculture and allied sectors also working in these areas. Apart from this, we have the non-farm sectors, which is comprising of small scale and cottage industries, and we also have rural consumption of these FMCG and durable goods industries. So moving on further, we discussed about the farm sectors and the non-farm sectors in India. The rural economy, as we have discussed, has farm and non-farm sectors. So farm sectors includes agriculture, that is basically production of crops. So we have a variety of crops like sugar, wheat, sugarcane, ragi, maize, millets, and we have plantation, we have animal husbandry, we have milk, meat, egg, etc. And we have forestry, we have fishing. All these are basically the activities that we see happening in the rural sector with the farm sectors. Whereas the non-farm sectors includes other activities like agro-processing industries, we have wholesale and retail trading, we have storage and communication, transportation, education, health, industries and other service-related activities. So we see that India is slowly raising up to not just only farm sectors, but also the non-farm sectors. So in a way, we are trying and moving ahead with both the farm and the non-farm sectors, which is contributing to the progress and development of our economy. So the well-known pattern of transformation that has been experienced by the different economies or countries when they move from the primary sectors to the tertiary sectors or from agriculture to the other sectors is the usually the movement is from agriculture, that is farm, to the manufacturing sector, and once they have moved to farm, then from there they are moving on to services. So this is one transformation cycle or this line that we see happening from agriculture to manufacturing and then to the services. So further we discussed about the diversification of agriculture, so which is very important in progress and development of Indian economy. So agricultural diversification refers to change in crop pattern of farmers opting for non-farming activities like poultry, animal husbandry, fishery, etc. So this helps to increase their income. So after Green Revolution, diversification has flourished rapidly. So basically we know that you can't stick to just one occupation or one source which will provide you employment as well as income or contribute to the GDP of the country. So agricultural diversification is very important. So you're just not depending on the crop pattern, but also moving to non-farming activities like poultry and animal husbandry, or it could be even fisheries, horticulture. So there are two types of agricultural diversification that is happening in India or that has happened in India. We see there is a horizontal diversification and a vertical diversification. So horizontal diversification refers to where people or the farmers are opting for multiple cropping or mix of crop. So it's very useful for small farmers who help to earn more as they can grow more than one crop in a small piece of land. So now if a farmer is poor, he doesn't have to worry because he is able to grow more than one crop in the same small piece of land. So he has multiple cropping happening, or there can be a mix of crop happening in his plot. Vertical diversification refers to a combination of industrialization along with multiple cropping. So here there is an addition with multiple cropping. There can also be industrialization happening wherein he moves to industrial sectors as well. So further we move on to the agriculture and allied activities. As we discussed, diversification moving from agriculture to other sectors is very, very important to the development of the country and also financially to the farmer. This would be of great help because he doesn't have to burden himself by depending only on agriculture or production of crops. So as we know, agriculture is the backbone of our economy. So other than that, if he is more than willing to do any other activity, people would be very happy because he is able to find new ways and means of earning and occupying himself. So the types of activities other than agriculture that we see happening in India are animal husbandry, dairy, fishing, floriculture, horticulture, poultry, etc. So there are a lot of other activities that the farmer is now shifting his concentration or moving further to earn by diversifying his activities. So broadly we see that when we take the non-farm employment in the rural areas, we have animal husbandry, we have dairying, we have fisheries, and we have the horticulture part. So what is animal husbandry? We know it is breeding and rearing of the farm animals, which is mainly for procuring, you know, meat, egg, wool, or any other product that would be helpful for the farmer. So now we see that this is also providing employment to the poor, and at the same time it is acting as a source of employment to women as well. Now when we move to dairying, we know again India has different types and varieties on breeds of cow, buffalo. So this is a business of producing and storing and distributing milk and its byproducts. So it includes breeding and raising of the dairy animals like goat, buffalo, sheep, etc. for milk. And we all know there's a huge demand and market for various products of milk. We buy milk, we buy curds, we buy the different sweets that are being produced by the dairy. So this is in huge demand. We all know how Amul has a big brand name and has its own place in India, and we have our local Nandini KMF which produces various byproducts of milk like paneer. You have the other sweet dishes which is available in the market. Moving on to fisheries, it involves catching and selling of fish, prawns or any aquatic animal. So it's basically very important source of livelihood to all these states which lie in the coastal areas. And again, this is contributing majorly to the economy of a country. Further with the horticulture, it is basically cultivating fruits, vegetables, flowers, etc. So again, as I discussed earlier, we know there is a huge demand for the Indian variety of mangoes, bananas. So we have a big market outside in the international level. So basically, these are the activities which are more sought after, which are bringing money to the people. We recently read in the newspapers and articles wherein, in spite of the lockdown, India was able to sell the jackfruits to Germany, which was in huge demand, and it is the organic product that has been sent, which is a big consignment to Germany. So this is a change that we are seeing happening in Indian economy and with the farmers who have brought a lot of changes. So further, moving on to cattle, wealth of India and dairy. We all know cattle farming involves the rearing and management of the animals, basically for milk and basically for, you know, plowing and other activities. So we have rearing of buffalo, cows, goats, etc. So there is a lot of demand for these products in our market. So we know dairying has become a secondary source of income to many of the rural families. It's not just providing employment, but it is also helping us, you know, to give the nutrient milk to the entire country, because we all know we had to bring in Operation Flood, wherein we had to collectively organize as cooperatives to collect the milk so that it is not wasted and it reaches every home in India. So it's not just rural, even the urban areas which we have able to reach. So this is a transformation that we see, and the kind of demand that we have for the dairy products. I think to ready to eat counters, like you have a variety of sweets that are made and are available in the market, which has huge demand, is trying to tell us how important dairy is to India for our economy as well. So further, summarizing about rural industrialization in India, we know again bringing industrialization in rural areas is very, very important. So we'll discuss about, we have discussed about this. So rural industrialization, as we all know, is basically encouraging or shifting of those small units, you know, basic industries that are there in the urban areas to the rural areas. So we are trying to bring in all-round development progress happening in these rural areas, so that it's not just the cities or the urban areas that we are mainly concentrating. We are trying to help basically the urban areas to move along with rural areas. So it's like parallelly, both the urban and rural areas are trying to improve. So coming to food processing industries and agro-based industry, again, this is one change that we see in India. Basically, There were many products that were grown, many fruits, vegetables, which would just, you know, rot, not making proper use of it. So a lot of wastage was happening, which we need to solve this problem by having proper processing industries in India, or giving importance to food processing in India. So we have discussed about all this in this video. So basically, food processing means conversion of the raw ingredients into food, or any form of food that is there, into something which you can make it edible. So basically, you can't have certain food in a raw form, so you're converting that and making it edible. Sometimes this food processing is like, you know, like it usually takes place when you have harvested the crops from farms or any animal product that is there, and that is used to make this processing happen, where you will actually add to the shelf life of the product. So we are trying to increase the shelf life of the products by this processing happening. So we usually discussed about the kind of processing that we see, one in manufacturing and the other one being value addition. So here we saw raw materials being converted to food, and in value addition we saw that there is increasing shelf life and the value of the marketed food. So as we all know, basically when you're just converting certain items to food, that would be just, you know, a process wherein you've moved it from raw to consumption level. But when you're adding shelf life by putting those products in a can, you know, a canned beans, or where you can the entire foods like pineapple and mangoes or anything into a can wherein you can store it and keep it for few months, basically adding the shelf lives or making use of them even without the seasons that are necessary to consume the food. Basically, we've discussed about the infrastructure aspects in the rural areas. So we all know infrastructure is very, very essential for development of the country. So if we want to progress, if our economy has to improve, we need to make sure that we are able to provide proper infrastructure. So rural infrastructure includes roads, it includes dams, includes irrigation activities, drainage, housing. It also includes electricity, communication, and water supply. So government needs to plan and bring an all-round improvement and changes in all these sectors. So the recurrent theme of public discourse during the last decade has been an inclusive growth. So we all know how important it is to have inclusive growth, which is very, very essential for socio-economic activity, since India's majority of the people are living in villages. It is easily seen that rural infrastructure is a major component of ensuring inclusive growth. So we all know it's not just your cities that can develop and progress. As long as you can't improve and connect your rural and the urban, we can't have progress. So rural electrification again plays a very important role. So whether it is for irrigation or setting up of small scale medium industries or khadi village industries or providing education or healthcare is very, very important. Also with the water supply system, as we have discussed, we know that we have to solve the problems of water, make sure that our lands are irrigated, people have access to good water so that they have good health. With housing infrastructure, basically we all know this is a basic thing that any human being expects to have. So to improve the standard of living, we need to provide them that food, clothing, shelter. So basically housing is a primary requirement for any farmer or Indian rural person. Overall, we see that development of rural power, irrigation, water sanitation, road infrastructure can actually increase productivity and also savings, because you're avoiding people commuting for unnecessarily, and you know, you're able to help tourism and also better jobs and health of the rural people. So I would like to thank everyone for viewing this video that I have made. Basically, this is a summary or a recap that I intend to make of the topics that we have discussed in agricultural economics. I hope it is very beneficial and useful to you. Thank you.